The response time of a task is defined as the time between the activation and the termination of a task. So this means in this example, we can see here on the left side, indicated by this black arrow, the activation of the task. And on the right side, we can see the termination. The complete time frame between activation and termination results in the response time of the task. So it measures the whole life cycle of a task, and it is influenced by every interference, such as preemptions, shown with this light green color, and also by start delays that are shown here with this gray color. So in this case, the task was activated, but it didn't run on the core for this time. It had a start delay. Then it was running, it got preempted, and finally it terminates. This overall time is the response time of this task. So how can you create such a requirement in the Timing Architect's tool suite? In the base part of the tool, you find a requirements editor that looks like this. You can select here, first of all, the task that you want to put a requirement on. Then in the metrics, you can search for response time and activate the metric response time. In the next field, you need to select which kind of limit you want to set. In this example, we want to use an upper limit for the response time of the task, 1 millisecond, and assign it 3 different severity levels. In this example, the task 1 millisecond is a periodic task, so we will assign a critical response time requirement at 90%, a major violation of the response time requirement at 80%, and the minor requirements violation at 70% of the period of this task. Let's now have a look at the evaluation result that we get if we use the response time requirement on the task 1 millisecond. First of all, you can see here the Gantt chart, which shows you all tasks that have been measured in the system, and you can find here the 1 millisecond task. Below, we are here in the process table, and the process table shows, in this example, the minimum, maximum, and average response time of the task 1 millisecond. So here you can already see that on average, the response time of this task is with 0.57 milliseconds, very much below the period of this task, but it looks like there are some events who exceed this response time quite highly with 1.5 milliseconds. Let's now have a look at the requirements table. In the requirements table, we can now see these 3 different requirements with the different severity levels, critical, major, and minor, as on the metric response time for the task 1 millisecond, and we can see the different limits with 0.9 milliseconds, 0.8, and 0.7 milliseconds. You can see here the different limits, and you can also see how often a certain violation happened. Now, if we focus on the critical requirement, let's drag and drop this requirement into the Gantt chart. You can now see that on every red arrow, this critical requirement was violated. And you can now scroll into the time frame in the Gantt chart where this violation happened. And you can always see with the red arrows where the violation was happening. If you additionally activate the interference view, you also have a very easy possibility to understand visually which task has been interfering with your task 1 millisecond that led to a violation of this response time requirement. Of course, you do not want to scroll through the whole Gantt chart to find all the violations. That's why you can open up a histogram. Into the histogram, you can now drag and drop this response time requirement, and you can now see here for the critical requirement where you have this deadline. Everything on the left fulfilled the requirement, everything on the right violated it. You can also go ahead and drag and drop additionally the major and minor requirements violation so that you have all three of them in this visualization. From this histogram, you can learn that in a lot of occurrences, the task 1 millisecond has a response time that is way below these requirements that we have defined. So more than 1,000 instances only had round about 0.48 milliseconds of response time. But there are a couple who are really extremely out of this response time. So now we are going to mark these outliers. We right click and send them to the clipboard. Now here on the right side in the clipboard, you can see all the instances that have been marked here. And if you double click on them and activate the interference view again, you will be very easily able to see what caused the task 1 millisecond to have such a long response time. So in this instance, you can see that the task engine RR was running for a very long time, so that after the activation, the task 1 millisecond was not running on the core and had a very long start delay. We can now click on the next instance, and we can also see that here the same task was interfering. So that's a very easy way to find out which task is interfering with these response time requirements, so that you can, based on this, come up with different ideas on how to solve the problem. At the end of this video, I want to offer you some possibilities to stay in touch and find out more about timing analysis. For that, I'm inviting you to join the LinkedIn group Runtime Analysis in AutoSAR Projects. In this group, you will meet other people working in this field, sharing their experiences and solutions for this topic. And you will, of course, also be able to engage in discussions and ask your questions there. Just search for the group directly on LinkedIn. Or if you want to have it easier, I put a QR code here in the video so you can simply scan the QR code and you will be redirected to this group. Would be happy to have you in the group. If you have questions to me directly, or if you want to connect with me, I'm inviting you to scan the QR code here on the right. You can also see the link to my profile here on LinkedIn. I would be very happy to connect with you and answer any questions you have. Thank you very much for watching this video. I'm looking forward to stay in touch with you.